Okay, thank you, Kamalian, for the kind introduction. And I will be organizer of this great event, Professor Sastry, Professor Mandal, and other the organizing members of this conference for inviting me. And Kamalian mentioned that I studied in Oxford, and during study in Oxford, he visited Oxford, and actually we worked very hard at that time. So I remember we sit on the microscope. And after 25 years, I'm sitting here, I'm standing here, and also it's my very great honor for me to give this presentation, mainly for the functional application. We need very hard from 1960s for the metallic glass. There has been great effort to increase the glass forming ability. So now we can have size between, as I indicated here, between 2 millimeter and 20 millimeters around this size. So the key factor for the enhancement of the glass forming ability is to lower the critical cooling rate for the glass formation. So I just show the critical cooling rate for glass formation here, and the glass transition temperature region is here. So in principle, the glass transition temperature region should be increased to enhance the glass forming ability of the alloy. So since that, so these days we have a lot of alloy systems which exhibit the high glass forming abilities. And this is an example of the bulk metal glasses fabricated in the magnesium-based systems. So that's the in 90s, a lot of work has been done to enhance the glass forming ability of the metallic glass systems. And after that, people want to enhance, improve the properties of the metallic glass systems. And of course, the structural purpose, the enhancement of the plasticity is one of the main points. So as you know, for the metallic glass, they have high strength and low elastic modulus. But in crystal material, we have the dislocation and grain boundary, so we have the plastic behavior. But in metallic glass, basically no dislocation or grain boundary, so inherently metallic glass is the brittle material. So we always have the catastrophe failure when we have the tensile stress on the metallic glass sample. So the way to improve the plasticity of metallic glass is to provide the heterogeneous in the glass matrix, and the scale of heterogeneous can be from the atomic scale and to the micrometer scale, as I showed here. So, and recently there are basically two approaches for the enhancement of the plasticity. So one way is to find out the system which exhibit the causal suitable equilibrium between dendritic phase and the glass matrix. And this is an example for the zirconium-based metallic glass system. So we have the systematic change of the properties depending on the changing of the alloy compositions, as you can see here. But still, we have the work softening, which is not good for the structural purpose. And the another interesting method is to have the primary crystalline phase, which can be deformed during the plastic deformation. So we can have the plastic deformation induced plasticity in the metallic glass matrix composite. So it shows just overall the work hardening behavior, as you can see here. But still, the distribution of the primary phase is not homogeneous and very sensitive to cooling rate. So we have that's the point we have to solve that towards. But but I think that the final goal may be to combine these two aspects. So we can have the tailored tensile properties as the and the overall work hardening in the metallic systems. So this is one of the approach within century. So in titanium, which side, which metallic glass, we could find out the pseudo equilibrium between glass matrix in beta phase, and we could get some tensile properties. But still, we have the necking, which means that we have to have the work hardening to have the optimized properties. So that's the just a brief introduction for the structural purpose of the metallic systems. And now I will talk about the functional aspects of the metallic systems. So as we know, we have the supercooled liquid region in the metallic systems. So during heating, if we start from the glass state, we have to enter into the supercooled liquid region, and then crystalline state, and then liquid state. And if you look at the change of the viscosity, then of course in the supercooled liquid region, we have the decrease of the viscosity, as you can see here. So and because of this decrease of the viscosity, we can have some thermoplastic forming in the supercooled liquid of metallic glass. So from these characteristics of the metallic glass, we can fabricate this type of the micro gear from the metallic glass system. And so by taking advantage of these characteristics, we can consider some the functional application of the metallic glasses, for example, micro-nano imprinting and glow forming, glow molding, and glass shape forming or spray printing. So this is an example of the application for the nanowire catalysis for the fuel cell. So this the nanowire sample has been prepared by the nano imprinting technique, as you can see here. And the point I would like to talk today is that recently we tried to use the metallic glass for the electronic device, that's for the contact formation in silicon solar cell. And so as you know, this is a schematic of the silicon solar cell. So this is silicon wafer and emitter is here, and this is a silver electrode. And to have the sound contact between the silver electrode and the silicon wafer, we have used the oxide glass clip for the binding materials for the silver powders. We know that the oxide glass is very non-conductive and very high flowable at high temperature, so they melt down to the interface, as you see here. So basic idea is to replace the oxide glass with the metallic systems. So this is a schematic diagram. We can expect when we use the metallic glass binders of the silver powders. And this work was in collaboration with Samsung Electronics, and when the Samsung people came at first, we just thought that phase-separating metallic glass may be suitable for this purpose. And actually, we have been working on the phase-separating metallic glass for 4 years, and we have shown that depending on the alloy compositions, we can have the interconnected structures by the spinodal decompositions or the Brownian structures by the nucleation and heuristic mechanisms. And of course, this type of the microstructures has been well documented in the oxide glass systems, but this is the first example shown in the metal glass systems. And those who are interested in phase separation, please refer a recent issue in the Progress in Material Science. As I mentioned before, so when Samsung people came as first, our suggestion was to use of the phase separating metallic glasses, because we have the silver, we have the copper phase metallic glass system, which phase separating, forming the AGC series of rich regions in the grass matrix, as I showed here. So this is very suitable for the conducting purpose of the metallic glass, because we have already silver particles and silver clusters in the metallic glass matrix. And so we have the other some useful characteristics for the use of the metallic glass for the contact formation. Particularly, it has the low specific resistance, so we can have very sound and very conductive contact between electrode and silver wafers. And here, I will point out that for this kind of purpose of the application, we have to consider the nanometer scale healing capability and oxidation resistance of metallic glasses. And most of the work on the metallic glass has been focused on the structural points of view, but very few work has been done on the functional application metallic glass. And for functional application metallic glass, we have to look at these properties because it's very important for the characteristics of the supercooled liquid region. So this is just an example, so I'm not going to detail, but we are looking at this part, and then we can see that very thin interface layer between silver and silicon, and the array of silver crystallized, but in the oxide gray system, we have very thick the interface layers. And after that, we thought that the of course, the copper-based system has the some silver clusters which can enhance the conductivity, but they have very low oxidation resistance. So now, after that, we thought about the use of the aluminum-based metallic glass for this purpose, because they have a very high oxidation resistance, and I will mention later, but they will form the amorphous oxide layer during the oxidation circumstances. So I'll just show you the result. So this is the result. So when we use the aluminum-based metallic glass for the contact formation, so we have very low contact resistance, as you can see here, when you compare with conventional oxide glass systems and also the copper plate systems. And also, we have very high cell efficiency, which means that the use of the metallic glass for the contact formation is very successful, and it can be extended to other electronic devices. So I believe this is one of the areas we can develop for the functional application of the metallic glass. And this is just a schematic showing the development of contact formation through the firing process. So this can be explained in a very simple way. So in the supercooled region, they will wet at the surface of the silver powders and the silver substrate, silicon emits the surface, and then they will have some reaction and they will have some contact morphology. And as you can see here, a very thin interface layer. And one of the, as I mentioned before, one of the important characteristics is the nano, thermal forming capability of the supercooled liquid region. And actually, before the Puma group has shown that the metallic supercooled liquid can heal the nanoscale mold spontaneously, but they did not think about the time required for healing the nanometer scale mold. But we developed the idea which can give us some the time scale which can heal the nanoscale channels in the supercooled state. For example, for this, under these circumstances, we have the powders and we have the metallic glass powders, and this is silver powder, for example. And this region shows that if we heat up the mixture, then we can see that within a very short time, the wetting occurs so we can have the wetting between the silver powders and the metallic glass, as you can see here. So the result is that time required to feed the nanometer scale channel is very short. In this case, below 0.5 sec. So which means that this is a very important property of the metallic glass, which is very useful for this type of the applications. So I'm not going to details about this, but we can refer our research paper titled Capillary Flow of Amorphous Metal for the High Performance Electrode. And as I mentioned before, there are two important characteristics. One is nano cavity filling capability, and the second one is the oxidation resistance of the metal glass. So we normally have the crystalline oxide on the metal surface, but if we have the amorphous oxide form, if the amorphous oxide forms instead of the crystalline oxide, then we can have more protective surface layer for the oxidation. This just show the schematic for this. And actually from the thermodynamics, we can consider that in terms of the bulk energy, of course the crystalline has the lower energy than the amorphous state, but if we think about the surface and the interfacial energy, then the amorphous structure has lower energy than the crystalline state, so there is some compromise between these two energy terms, which means that we have the critical thickness of the amorphous oxide layer which can form on the metal surface. So it is known that in the case of the aluminum, the critical thickness of the amorphous oxide layer is around 3 nanometers, you can see here. And the experimenter shows that we have the here this is the aluminum oxide, amorphous oxide layer formed on pure aluminum. Then we can see that the about 10 to 30 nanometers thickness amorphous oxide layer, but at the high temperature, it transforms to the crystalline state. And I will just briefly show our result. So this is the amorphous oxide layer, as you can see here. So we saw in the early days we tried very hard to develop the metal glass which has high glass forming abilities, but this result shows that for the oxide glasses and for the oxide layer, we can also think about the same story for the glass forming tendency for the oxide layer. So for this case, we can just consider the electronegativity and the atomic size, which also can be considered for the case of the metal glass. And we found that the ethereum has larger atomic size than the other elements, which meant that the inclusion of ethereum may enhance the glass forming tendency of the oxide layer. And I'll just show one more result. So if we heat up at 600 degrees Celsius, and then if we hold at that temperature for 15 hours, and we still have the amorphous structures, as you can see, of course we have formation of the crystalline oxide at the interface, but still, and also we can notice the thickness is between 30 to 100 nanometers. This is very huge thickness of the amorphous oxide layer, and this has been reported so far in any crystalline materials. And we think there is some issues to be solved for the origin of the such a large thickness of the oxide layer, which can form in the metal systems. And because of time I stay here, and so today I try to emphasize that there are so many efforts for the structural application of metallic glass systems, and there has been some successful stories, but still we have to go a long way for the successful application. And also you can look at the functional application of the metallic glasses. And if we look at the metallic glass materials from the other field, for example, electronics art, then we can find out some very interesting applications. As I showed, so actually there are many other, I believe there are many other examples which can be applied for this purpose. Thank you for your attention.
That's all right.
No, no, no.